Warning, this is the Freedom Fiends midweek non-radio podcast. Unlike our weekend live talk radio shows, where we adhere to all regulations and community standards, this cast may contain cussing and or prurient subject matter. If you are easily offended, please leave now. But tune in Saturdays and Sundays to our live talk radio show. If you're not easily offended, prepare to be entertained, informed, and enlightened.
This is the Central Scrutinizer. We're working very hard to spend your tax money to keep you from hearing things like freedomfiends.com.
No, we're recording.
Oh, we are.
Yes. Okay. I'm going to start recording because your time is so precious now. I got to get something down. This is your first post-baby cast. You went out and bred. You're typing with one hand, which doesn't mean you're masturbating. It means you're holding a baby. We have a new thing where you type 1H.
1H.
Means I'm typing with one hand. Can't do complete sentences. The baby makes you retarded, basically.
Yeah.
Did this fix the problems with the clicking on your end, Neema?
It's still there. It's less. What'd you do?
I had alternate DNS servers set up because I was experimenting with the .bit top-level domain.
Okay. It's better.
And I switched it back.
You know. Yeah, it's tolerable now.
Yeah. So instead of going through, like, Google's DNS or whatever, I was going through, like, you know, Pierre in rural Paris's, you know, bedroom server or something.
Okay, that'll do it.
Yeah, I think so.
All right, cool. You know. I'm ready.
All right, yeah, man. So we just did all this crap dealing with cats walking on mixers and all sorts of stuff, and I'm really, like, cranky and, like, ready to talk about redemption, goddammit.
Fucking redemption in the third act. Yeah, it's
not
upon
the third
us.
Act.
Oh. Redemption in the first act. We're doing it backwards.
The redemption.
We're going to start with redemption, and we're going to end with
tyranny.
Tyranny.
The redemption apocalypse is upon us. Yeah, so I wrote you the other day. I had, like, these three kind of really redemptive things happened in my life, mostly from me, like, making amends with people and feeling good about it, and them feeling good and good things coming from it. And then you did what you do. You get a baby, right?
Well, my wife had a baby. She had my baby.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure.
You were there, huh?
I was there. Yeah, I was there in the room.
Fiends want to know. Fiends want to know, man, all about this, man. First half hour's baby. Second half hour and third are all me. No, I'm kidding. Second one's all me, and third one's the redemption in the third act for everything.
Yeah.
All right.
People say having a baby will change your life, and I think they're right. And yeah, it's a cliche, but it's true, man. Like, before you have the baby, it's all about you. And now literally every thought is on, I hope I don't kill this baby.
No, before you had the baby, I wanted to think that your every thought was about me. And now, and now I'm frustrated because you can't say, we'll start at 5, you know, 5 p.m. sharp. You're like typing me with one hand at 5 p.m. like, it'll be a few more minutes. And I'm like, hey, Homer just put Velcro on Maggie and put her on the wall when he's working in the wood shop.
Yeah, but he's Homer.
Yeah.
I don't want to be Homer.
And we have a new thing.
Although it could be worse.
You type 1H if you have a baby in your hand.
See, when I was 7 and my mom had Frank, when I came to the hospital, she had a goodie bag for me, kind of a consolation prize.
A bribe to not kill your brother.
She got me WrestleMania on the Nintendo Entertainment System. Okay. So I was like, sweet. When my mom has a baby, I get video games. So do you need me to send you a video game, Michael?
No, you sent me, you sent DJ and I, well, actually you sent our cats some sushi toys that are pretty fucking cool.
Yeah, well, there was a taco. Did you get the taco too?
We didn't open them all up yet. We're going to dole them out like the 12 catnip sushi toys of Christmas.
Good. Yeah, I was trying to get you guys a household gift because we've got so many people for Christmas. We decided we're going to do one gift per household.
I know. I was like, is your baby, you know, do you have to run and get your kid? Can we work on this? How fast do we have to, you know, sound check and get this problem fixed? You're like, there are 5 adults in the other room all gathered around the baby. I have time. Who are they? Grandma?
It's only 3. It's mom, grandma, and brother-in-law. Well, I guess uncle to the baby.
Cool.
Yeah.
You called me and DJ your anarchy, Lily's anarchy aunt and uncle. I like that.
Yeah, instead of the godmother.
Yeah.
Well, did I say uncle?
Well, that means that if, like, the parents perish, it's up to DJ and I to raise your child in an anarchy-based environment.
Exactly. That's
what
I'm
not doing
that.
I'm not going to raise someone else's kid. But if something happened to you guys and, like, some statist relative was I'd secretly I'd go back on Facebook and friend her and start, like, sending her Spooner books and stuff.
There you go.
So there, I would mean.
Help, yeah, yeah. You don't have to raise her. You just have to educate her. Yeah. But there's plenty of non-statists in my family, so I'm not too concerned.
You guys should have a TV show, your whole extended family. The Anarchy family.
Not a bad idea. Yeah, I think people would go for that. The only catch is we all live in different places, so it'd be hard to shoot.
The classic TV model is a bunch of people all living in one place.
Right.
Going back to, like, I don't know, I Love Lucy and the Neighbors and the Dick Van Dyke Show and the Neighbors. You know, they're all in the same building, at least.
I don't know what that is. No, I do. I'm not that young, unfortunately. I'm not young at all. I have a freaking baby. I mean, I'm a grown-up now. I can't help it.
Well, Jeff Riggenbacher, what's his name? I should know.
Riggenbach
told me the other day that he's like Ted Baxter on the Mary Tyler Moore Show. And I thought I don't know
what that is. Yeah, that's legitimate. I have no idea what any of those things are, except for Jeff Riggenbach.
They're like sitcoms that ended when I was four. You know, when they were like babysitting me with the TV. Yeah.
Yeah.
So your baby. Go ahead.
My baby. Yes.
Mine.
Lily. It's tough, man. It's life-changing. And they say when you're in the hospital, it's kind of like baby boot camp. Like, you have the baby and it's like, oh, fuck. What do I do? What do we do now? And they kind of lock you away in this room alone, just you, your wife, and the baby. And it's up to you to, like, figure it out. I felt like I was on an episode of Survivor.
I thought you were going to say they, like, have, you know, a slideshow and it's like drunk driving class or something.
No. They did have one. There's one video that they really push you to watch. And it's the period of purple crying. And it's basically 15 minutes telling you not to shake your baby. And that your baby's going to cry, don't shake it. But, you know, I guess the angle now is don't feel frustrated. This is normal. The baby's going to bawl. You're not going to be able to do anything about it. Go take a walk. Leave the baby in the crib in a safe position like you leave him to sleep. And go do something you enjoy and let the baby cry it out. Don't sit there and get more frustrated.
I would know that intuitively because that's what I do when cats are bugging me.
When cats are bugging you. Yeah. Yeah. But I think the baby's really going to help. I think babies kind of help you to mature because you realize you can't throw a fit. You can't do like you do with adults and match a temper tantrum with another temper tantrum. You have to remain calm because literally that baby's life is in your hands. And it's really sobering to me. It's almost as sobering as when I started carrying a gun. Because, you know, when you start to carry a gun, you realize you have the power, you know, and you got to not use it irresponsibly. You have to realize that you've taken on a big responsibility. And, you know, a baby is orders of magnitude higher than that, I think. But to me, it's almost in the same sort of pool or pond.
Okay, I'm making a new button order right now. You could keep talking. I'm making a button order for one that says, babies are like guns, the freedom fiends. Not really.
Yeah. I don't know about that.
So did the doctor come in, like, on The Simpsons and hand you a pamphlet that says, so your childhood is gone? Or something like that. So your life is ruined. You have no privacy ever again.
No. It wasn't really dramatic. We had one nurse, Nurse Charlotte. I'll call her out. She was awesome. She was amazing. She's really what made the situation good because, you know.
She delivered the baby and then the doctor just came in and, like, took credit. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
And sent you a bill.
The way it works in the hospital system, it is. There's status leakage throughout the whole way it works. And, you know, there's rules, there's regs, and there's much less choice than you would hope to have. And our doctor, you know, we really didn't like her at all. She kind of pushed us to go into the hospital. We got the sense that she just really wanted to be home with her family for the holidays, you know, because Christmas is coming. We got the sense that she was just punching a clock and was trying to get everybody out of there so she could go home. And she even said as much. She said, hey, I got four other of my patients in that hospital right now. They're going to be I'm going to be delivering babies for them today, you know? And it's like, well, we don't care. We don't care about your schedule, lady. We want to make sure that Jessica's safe and healthy and the baby's safe and healthy. And we wanted to avoid a C-section at all costs. And when you try to do a lot of interventions or when the hospital pushes you to do a lot of interventions like Pitocin and induction and breaking the water, then that kind of stuff can lead to things like a C-section. C-section, and the doctor wasn't really feeling our vibe of, hey, let's do this as naturally as possible, i.e. let's not cut open my wife's stomach. And we would tell her as much, and the doctor would literally visibly get frustrated, like a baby. Like, she would do these big hand gestures and say things like, well, you can just sit there in the bed then, you know, just lay there. It was really off-putting.
Who did that?
The doctor.
Oh, man.
Yeah. She was really pushy, and there's no pun intended there. The nurse Charlotte, was really what made the situation cool. She would listen to our concerns, and she helped us through it, and she helped us to make the plan and then stuck to it. She didn't try to make the plan for us. And if it weren't for her, you know, it could have gone a lot worse. So big props to Nurse Charlotte. And I guess that's a good lesson, too, is that even if the system is kind of screwy, if you can find a good person to help you navigate it. People are still people, and that's where humanity comes from, is people. That's why it's called humanity. So thank God we found Nurse Charlotte, or we're lucky enough to have her helping us out.
Nice.
Yeah, but the thing was, is at that point, you can't really ask for a new doctor, you know? You can't say, oh, well, we're already in this hospital, can we get a new doctor? You know, she's the only one there. Yeah. And it's time. You can't really shop around at that point.
Yeah. Yeah. So what's home life like now?
I guess that's the other thing that changes is, sleep is a precious commodity now. So the babies come out, and apparently It's pretty common that they're night owls. Like, they want to be awake at night. And when they're in the womb, they're swishing around, you know, when the mom's walking and going about her daily life. So that puts them to sleep. And then they wake up and play at night like cats. And so when they come out, they're still on that schedule. So Lily wants to sleep all day, and then at night she wants to be fed every half hour. So I try to help out as best I can. You know, I wake up, and if Jessica needs an extra hour or so of sleep, I'll take Lily in the other room and sort of sing lullabies to her. Apparently, that's the good thing to do. Hmm. I'll play synthesizer for her and, you know, try to lull her back to sleep so that Jessica can get a few Z's and then wake up and then feed the baby.
Yeah.
It's still a really good thing, you know. I guess part of the theme of the show is redemption and rebirth, and there's nothing really that highlights that more than having a baby. You know, she's literally the definition of a clean slate. And I guess I've come to it, it's taught me that a clean slate for humanity, it's kind of inevitable, right? Because that's the humanity reproduces through babies. And when they come out, they're completely clean. They don't have indoctrination. They don't have statism in their bones. There's no human nature that makes them want to dominate others or be dominated. They come out a blank sheet of paper. And I think that it's a great example of what we're here trying to do is inoculate people from indoctrination. And it's much easier if they haven't been indoctrinated yet. You know, that's what inoculation is it happens before the disease. So I'm totally stoked.
Trying to think of like intelligent follow-up questions. Oh, is that a relative saying, oh, we love the pictures you sent us?
That's the other thing.
Sending a lot of pictures?
Yeah. Well, here's the thing is we wanted to be the ones, you know, posting the announcement, but we're so freaking tired after the 20 some hours of labor and doing all that.
And I was like, I'm going to do it. I wrote it 2 weeks ago. What are you talking about, man? That's how proactive I am.
Yeah, and that's really what publicist. We should have done. It's really exactly. That was great. And that's what we should have done.
And you guys were
end.
Like, and like, you know, I didn't ask when we were doing the show, when she was going into labor, when I was doing the show with Ben, you sent me a couple emails and like, oh, she's dilated. Call Ron Paul. I read those on the air. I didn't think to ask you, but, you know, I was also thinking like, it's a public event. It's not, you know, it's not an Edward Snowden kind of secret. And then the next day, like, I was trying to get a picture from you to do an announcement because you'd been in there 24 hours. You had the kid, but you guys weren't letting me tell anyone you had the kid yet. And I was like, people are going to start worrying if they're like,
well, what we meant is you can tell people, just don't post it on a public forum.
Okay. But, well, I mean, yeah, the show is a public forum. I mean, this is like the first time I've talked to you since you guys went in the hospital, really.
That's true. You know? I mean, we chatted for a few minutes on the phone, but and what I learned too is We really didn't want other family members.
I chatted with you on the phone when you were had just arrived at the hospital, I think. Didn't I?
No, we talked the other day when I went out to get the wife some
food.
Yeah. But I guess what we were thinking of is nobody should post on Facebook until we do. But I sent pictures, you know, through text to family members, and they all posted on Facebook instantaneously. And then all of a sudden, every family member from across the country just started posting from Facebook, like relatives in Salt Lake and and other places. And I was like, oh yeah, should have thought of that.
You're like, hey, why are people socially networking these things I put on a social network?
But that's just it. Yeah, you can't really, you can't prevent that stuff.
But it's a lot of configuration on Facebook where you have to like have sets of just family only and then tweet to them. But then they'll just copy it to their desktop and send it to people.
Yeah. Yeah. No,
they'll
email it to somebody.
Yeah.
I think it's the lesson I always talk about with IP is, you know, if the media is out there, if it's out there in ones and zeros, it's going to get shared no matter how much you throw a fit about it or tell people not to. It's going to get shared. I think next time we just got to be the first ones to do it. If we want to make the first announcement, we're the first ones with the information. So we should announce first immediately because if we don't, other people will.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I don't know. No harm, no foul. I mean, really, I'm not that upset about it. People got to see Lily. They got to like the posts and like the pictures and chat and say, oh, what a beautiful gift from God and all the things that people say when babies are born. So it's a good thing.
I'm looking at your Facebook. There's a picture that looks like someone offering her a giant piece of chocolate.
That's a burrito.
Is that you holding a burrito? Okay, I see.
Yes, it's me holding up a Freebirds burrito.
Oh, to show this, to the baby size compared to this giant burrito.
Yes.
If the baby is about
even the giant size of burrito.
The baby is like 1.5 burritos.
Yeah. Well, that's the regular size burrito. The large burrito would probably be bigger than her, and that's the monster probably twice as big as her. She's tiny, man. They lose weight after they're born because they've got all that. They call it meconium. It's basically the poop from when they were fetuses, and it all has to come out after they're born. And so they're born a few ounces heavier than when they're going to leave the hospital. So after that, you know, you breastfeed and you try to get them to up their weight. Their weight up, all that kind of stuff. But it's really weird because, you know, when you think about having a baby, at least when I did, I was thinking about her being a little girl or a toddler, or, you know, you don't really imagine a newborn for some reason, even though that's what's going to happen. And newborns are kind of a whole different game.
They're not
some
really call it male or female either. They're kind of like just newborn.
Kinda, yeah. Well, people call it the fourth trimester. You know, they still want to be in the womb and they act like it. You know, they want to just lay around and have you take care of all of their needs for them. And they're not really that interested in much of anything at all yet.
Yeah, I think a lot of the problem with today's society is that like that is extended by society up to about the 40th trimester. Or 80th.
What was that? There was that show. Oh, it was South Park, where Cartman's mom goes and sleeps with all the politicians until she gets up to Bill Clinton because she's trying to get 40th trimester abortions legal so she can get rid of Cartman.
But then there was some lady. Well, no, I don't want to go into tyranny and what some Obama humper said on MSNBC. I was going to, but it's just such a habit of like, well, there's some tyranny connected to that, but no. No.
Well, you also you kind of get a better perspective too of the think about the children and the safety Nazis. Not that I'd ever go in that direction, but I can kind of see more where it comes from. Like I'm worried. I've never been worried about anything in my life. I'm not a worrier. I'm a laid back kind of guy, you know, especially about myself and my own health. I kind of feel invincible, and I guess a lot of people my age do. But once you have a kid, man, it's like, geez, she's fragile. She's delicate. I want to make sure nothing happens to her. You know, I think the biggest threat to her is the state. So I don't go in the direction of saying, won't somebody please think of my child? Because I know that a politician won't think anything good of my child other than she's a potential voter at some point or a potential cannon fodder.
Or and a potential taxpayer probably.
Exactly. Yeah. Or tax cattle. Wouldn't be any of those things.
Or even if she's none of the above, like someone they can count in a census and say, there's this many people that need our protection in this area.
Or we have this big of a population, so buy our bonds.
Buy our bombs. Bond bombs.
Buy our bombs.
Bond bombs. Yeah, bonbons. So, yeah, I mean, see, we're already going to tyranny. We can't help it, man. But, yeah, I understand. You know, actually, like, something I never even considered, because I wrote this birth announcement for you guys and sent it to Talkers and GCN, and GCN printed it, and Talkers wrote me back and said, oh, sorry, man, we don't usually do, like, birth announcements unless it's, like, you know, the biggest rock stars of talk radio. And then, and even then, we usually don't, and we have good reasons for it. And I thought about it, like, what would the good reasons be? And I wrote and said, are the good reasons that, one, if you published birth announcements, Talkers would be nothing but birth announcements, and there'd be no room for anything about radio? And number two, if you're doing talk radio right, someone ends up hating you, and you don't want that to extend to family members. Huh. And he wrote back, and he said, exactly right on both counts. And this is after GCN had already published it. But I don't think anyone's going to come after your baby because you're on Freedom Fiends.
I would hope not.
I mean, I didn't just put another worry in your head. No. No. Take it away. Take it away.
Okay. Okay. Well, I mean, that's why they killed the 16-year-old boy they droned. When they droned him and the White House press secretary was asked about what happened, he said, well, he should have had a better father. So, I mean, statists throughout history and violent people throughout history have never put, you know, families in a separate category from their enemies. They're kind of at their enemies.
I think he was talking about, like, you know, crazy people going on Facebook or something, or, you know, egging Rush Limbaugh's, you know, cousin's house or something. But, and it's funny that we couldn't not go to some tyranny, man. Also, you've just been pent up. You haven't done, you know, a Fiends with Tyranny in a while.
That's true. That's true. Yeah, I have been pent up, but I haven't really been focused on the tyranny. I've been focused on the redemption, man.
Good. Well, I won't tell you any of the new tyranny then.
You can if you want.
No.
No.
Well, one that was pretty funny was a federal judge ruled that NSA's massive spying on Americans was illegal, and then and then, like, a day later reversed it. I think the NSA probably went to him with, like, I don't know, my joke
his,
is
his,
like,
his porn habits.
Yeah, like his porn habits and his, you know, secret bank accounts. I'm not saying that guy has porn habits or secret bank accounts or a mistress or offshore or whatever, but no, that's, I imagine they do things like that all the time. And isn't that bizarre? Right. Like, a day later he just said, oh, sorry, I was mistaken.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, that's the old joke, is the NSA spying on your congressman since 1950. Because, think about what kind of power an organization that has the ability and the want to spy on everybody in the country. I mean, it's all right there. They have the ability or the power and the desire to blackmail anybody they want. So it seems like they'd have a lot more string pulling and shot calling ability than a lot of people, I think, give them credit for.
Yes.
Negative credit, if there is such a thing.
Yes.
Yes. So yeah, man. I don't know. I guess I don't want to focus on the tyranny, but I think you have to talk about it a little bit to talk about what the alternatives are and to have the redemption, right? You have to have conflict first before you can have some kind of redeeming or redemption.
Yeah, but we've had 300 episodes of conflict.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
That's right. Yeah. We find some redemption in the third act sometimes.
Yeah. I'm not going to tell you about the guy from some radio show that called me the other day that wanted help on
I think I know who you're talking about.
I was just like, I'm busy, I gotta go. I thought
was it the actual host?
No, it was a guy who's like him that he's hired to do his calling, to get him on radio so he can say that Obama's a homo and a secret Muslim, and that Muslims are horrible, but they're better than Christians because at least Muslims execute gay people. Yeah, that show. That
are guy, people actually doing the Obama's a homo thing now?
Oh, he said that on the air. But someone from his group called me, and I was just like, no, man, I have workmen here. I got to go. And I did, but it was like, I called the person that gave him my number and was like, don't, you know how I feel about them. Don't. And he's like, oh, man, I'm sorry. But it was funny because it was like, I thought about later what I should have said was, oh, I'd like to help you, man, but I'm busy about to have gay sex with a transsexual Muslim illegal immigrant unwed father. I should have said that.
You should have said that.
While shooting crocodile into my penis. Yeah.
Mm, that might be fun.
Yeah.
No, not really, though. Yeah. I still don't get the whole gay thing, but I don't know. It's a generational thing.
You mean the
thing.
Whole anti-gay thing?
Yeah, exactly.
Sounded like this guy without explanation.
Oh, I did.
Don't get this gay
well, people
thing.
People know. People know what
no,
I mean.
No, they don't.
They don't? Okay. No. Well, this isn't on radio. This is our
well,
podcast.
Well, this guy sued Rachel Maddow for defamation, for something that wasn't even defamation. Like, she basically showed the guy's own words. And he lost, and he's having to pay Rachel Maddow $25,000 for her legal fees.
Eey. Well, yeah. I actually don't mind because I don't like them. So
yeah. So anyway, that's not good stuff. Let's move on.
Okay.
Hey, I got something for you. You should on your Twitter feed, you should update it. It says like Rhymesayer podcaster. It should be Rhymesayer radio personality or talk show host.
Yeah, it should.
Yeah, it really should.
Okay. Okay.
Yep.
I'll update my tweets, yo.
Yo.
Yeah. I enjoy Twitter. A lot.
I enjoy the Twitters. I love it so much more than Facebook. First of all, it's just summaries, basically. And if you want to go thing, you go click on it. You know, it's not and it's it also doesn't do the thing. It actually shows you the tweets that you're subscribed to. Whereas Facebook, you know, like their business model is horrible, man. I mean, they basically like for a while, like everything was wild and free and it was groovy. And then they put ads on, which I'm fine with. But now they do a thing where like if you have 1,000 followers or 1,000 friends on Facebook and you tweet something, like 20 of them see it.
Yeah.
Unless you pay. It's
ridiculous.
Post.
Yeah, but Twitter's not like that. Twitter is democratized, I guess. One tweet and all your followers get it.
Yeah. You know, when this is kind of a funny aside related to you being a daddy. When I posted that that tweet about or the Facebook post about your kid with the picture, and you know, every fiend was waiting with bated breath, and like all of a sudden people started clicking like on it and sending it around, and it ended up getting like 90 likes. Whereas like I put this morning on our Facebook, I put Chris Novoselic from Nirvana is going to be the guest on the Freedom Fiends this Saturday, and it got one like. I mean, come on, man. Facebook's fucking broken. Facebook's fucking broken.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
But I put your thing up, and somehow it got like 90 posts because everyone was just looking for it, you know, and going looking for it. Got like 90 likes. And then I keep getting like 3 times in 3 days. I get this note from Facebook that says, your post, Neema Vedadi is a daddy, is doing better than most of your other posts. If you'd like it to do even better, for only $30, $60, or $100, you can reach all of your followers. And I was thinking,
yeah,
like,
shouldn't you reach them anyway? They're
I was thinking,
your
like,
followers.
Fuck you, like, Facebook. Like, what if I'd posted, like, my cat died and everybody posted, like, and then sympathies, you know? Like, would you like to, you know, they're fucking robots. I hate being marketed to by robots, man.
Yeah.
I hate
too. It. Yeah. The only bot I really like is on Twitter. It's the Your Mom bot. And if it follows you, it posts, it reposts or retweets what you tweet saying your mom and then your tweet. So. Your mom thinks Edward Snowden is a hero. That kind of stuff.
That's awesome.
Yeah. So
that's awesome.
It is. And the other thing I like about Twitter more than Facebook is it's a lot harder to have a bunch of idiots complaining and bitching back and forth at each other
really
and
is.
Arguing. You know, you don't have flame wars really on Twitter because it's annoying and you can't go back.
I've heard of them, but they're. They only work if the person has like 70,000 followers and he's participating. Like I saw this one. Actually, there's some cool websites now that basically, like I've said, that the mainstream media all it exists for now is to point you to things on the internet. Mm-hmm. There's some site that's, you know, it's some mainstream magazine and they have a section of like what's trending in Twitter. And there was this hilarious thing where some comedian, I don't know who he is, but he had like 70,000 listeners, said something about. Some salsa. What's the salsa that they have the ads?
Oh, Taste.
Yeah. Did you see this whole thing?
A little bit of it. I didn't look into it. It wasn't
like
that
he made a joke about Pace and like he got an angry lawyer tweet from someone at Pace, like asking him to remove it.
Okay.
You know, but it said like, hey, this is Bill. I'm the head of social media networking at Pace Incorporated. Please remove this. And he just started going into this insanely funny Twitter war with some, at first it was a robot. And then they got like the social media marketing kid hired out of high school to like send him lawyer letters. And then that guy got fired over this because like somebody realized, oh, wait, you know, you're doing us harm by telling this comedian not to be funny about our product.
Yeah, and yeah. You're always going to lose that, man.
And then
comedians win every time.
And then they offered to send him like a case of free chili or, you know, salsa. And he's like, no, I don't take bribes. Tell your law bot that. And then he wrote back like the next day, like, I've changed my mind and I'm willing to take a bribe. But first you have to send me a picture of, you know, whatever the guy is, the David or whoever the guy that got fired. Like, I want to know where David is. I want a picture of David holding today's newspaper in good health. You know, like, it was funny, man.
Yes. He's been sacrificed to the salsa gods.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So Lily got her first Bitcoin. Someone anonymously sent.
Oh, awesome.
Did you get that? I sent. It's in your Bitcoin wallet.
I'm sure it is. I haven't opened my wallet in a while. But
it had a message in it that said anonymous gift for Lily. Welcome to Earth, baby fiend. Your daddy is working hard to make it a better place. Congratulations, Neema.
That's sweet. Yes.
Yep.
So she's starting off her first few bits of life with Bitcoin and silver. The bad Quaker sent Lily some silver too. So she's got a good little start.
So I have a tip for fiends out there. Buy Namecoin. That's all I'm going to say. It's kind of like in The Graduate where the guy says, I have one word for the future, son. Plastics. My one word for the future is Namecoin. Also, Norton antivirus is saying that the Namecoin wallet is a virus, or it's like saying, do you want to delete this? Not many people have used this. We're not sure if it's good. Like, it's the grandpa bot. It's saying, this is new and strange, and I don't understand it. Do you wish to outlaw it?
It's grandpa's internet.
It really is, man.
Yeah, screw that. Although I do have a correction for Lily. She is still a potential fiend. You know, part of the fiend thing is she owns her. You know, she gets to decide. If she doesn't want to be a fiend, then more power to her. I think it's very likely that she will be a fiend, though. So,
what if she runs for president and becomes a total statist Democrat?
I will cry. But I will try to convince her, and I'll probably win. I don't think it'll ever get to that point. But I don't know. I'm a freedom-loving guy and a self-determination down to the individual, not like a national self-determination Woodrow Wilson kind of thing. And for instance, we bought a lot of clothes for her from like not flea markets, but like garage sales and baby clothes. You know, used baby clothes flood the market. Like, we got a whole closet full of clothes.
Everybody, including us, sent you a bunch of new baby clothes.
Yeah, we got new ones. We got old ones. We got more baby clothes than she'll ever be able to wear, which is a good thing. It's a quality problem. But some of the used ones we bought say things like, I love my aunt or my uncle's awesome. And I'm just thinking, what if she doesn't think that? What if she fucking hates her aunt, you know? I don't want to put words in her mouth when she's just a tiny infant.
I like those coffee cups that say, like, world's number for dad.
right. So yeah, man, Lily is still her own person, even though she's tiny. And that's a really mind-blowing thing too, is she came out and she looks at you and you look her in the eye and you realize she's a person. She's a human being.
She's,
you
know? She's not a fiendlet.
She's not a fiendlet. No, not yet. She is that blank slate, but she's still got as much pure humanity in her as any of us do. And it's more pure because she hasn't yet been corrupted.
Michael Harrison from Talkers made up that awesome term, fiendlet.
Fiendlet?
Yeah. When he was like, apologize, like, hey, sorry, we don't do birth announcements, but hey, congratulations to Neema on his new fiendlet.
Fiendlet. I like that. Yeah. Yeah, we've got a few nicknames for her already. What are they? Typical Neema fiend fashion. Well, we call her Lily Putin a lot.
Ew.
I guess it's supposed to be Lilliputian, you know,
but because
she's so
Putin.
Tiny.
I think of Putin.
Yeah, people say that, but I don't know. Lily Putin sounds cooler to me than Lilliputian.
If she farts, it could be Lily Putin.
Putin. Yeah. There you go.
If
Lily Rubin.
Farts. If that human ever farts,
yeah,
I assume they do.
Oh, she does.
My cat's fart.
Yes. We can hear her pooping. We should call her Lily Poopin. But yeah, we also call her Lily Rubin because, I don't know, jargon that people expect you to know kind of bugs me. And we were in the hospital and they kept talking about these bilirubins. They're like, oh, as long as your bilirubins are okay, then you can be discharged tomorrow. I'm like, what the fuck is a bilirubin? Apparently it has something to do with jaundice, and they do this test. And some PhD somewhere who was doing research, I guess their names were combined and it was bilirubin or something.
See, you didn't read the right books. You didn't spend enough money at
my wife knew what
it was. Child industrial complex. complex.
See, maybe that's why they felt they didn't have to explain it, because my wife knew instantly.
Okay.
I was just like, right. So I've been saying Billy Rubin is my when I hear a new word, I latch onto it and I use it in the place of everything all the time until I find a place for it. You know, that's kind of the way I work linguistically, and so its place right now is I've changed Lily's name into that. So every now and then she's Lily Rubin, and when she's hungry, it's her Belly Rubbins instead of her Billy Rubins. So
cool.
Yeah.
So we should go to the market. It's before this crashes. All right. Yeah.
This is Neema Vedadi from the Freedom Fiends. Using government-printed funny money fuels and encourages wars abroad and the wars at home against you and all you hold dear. Why should you remain beholden to self-appointed federal kings who don't care if you starve in a cage? Become your own king today by owning gold and silver from Midas Resources. Go to freedomfiends.com and click on the Midas Resources banner over on the right, or go to gold.freedomfiends.com. That's gold.freedomfiends.com.
You've read books, attended lectures, and you know the Constitution well enough to know it's a well-crafted blueprint to create an ever-increasing federal empire. But there's still one thing missing.
Buttons!
Freedom Fiends now has buttons. You'll get state speech is hate speech, guns and weed,
buy sheep for sheep on sheep,
and two designs for the Freedom Fiends. Wear them with pride. Use them to start conversations with statists.
It's only $10 for 10 buttons, including shipping.
Go to freedomfiends.com and click on the link at the top that says Buttons.
Hey, this is Nathan Explosion from Death Clock, and you're listening to Freedom Fiends on the radio. Worms.
What does freedom mean? Tune in to LRN.FM to find out. LRN.FM is the Liberty Radio Network, a collection of live talk radio and podcasts, all coming from a principled pro-liberty perspective. LRN.FM show hosts aren't left, right, or conspiracy kooks. You can tune in 24/7 to LRN.FM via your phone, computer, satellite, and more. Listen free anytime at LRN.FM. That's LRN.FM.
The Electronic Frontier Foundation, or EFF, fights to protect your rights in the digital world. When a patent troll threatened podcasters, they fought back. EFF has also defended your right to encryption and has sued the NSA to end the government's mass, suspicionless surveillance. There are different ways you can help EFF, from donations, to signing petitions, to writing your representatives, to just spreading the word. Find out more at EFF.org. That's EFF.org.
Do you want to raise your children outside of the government indoctrination camps that are today's public schools? Check out the Ron Paul Curriculum link over on the right of freedomfiends.com. The Ron Paul Curriculum is a liberty-based K-12 homeschool course. It covers history, liberty, geography, math, science, and free market economics. Kindergarten through fifth grade are free. Then it's only $250 per family per year. Click on the Ron Paul Curriculum link over on the right side of freedomfiends.com. That's freedomfiends.com.
Love the Fiends and want to help out? We do take donations and we put them back into our Liberty Projects. You can make a donation by clicking on the spinning coin on any post. But what if you want to help, but you ain't got no cash? Or you made a donation and you want to help more? Here's how you can help. Download and seed our torrents to help keep us drone-proof. There's a Torrent Club link at the top of freedomfiends.com. You can also blog the Fiends and share episode links on Facebook, Twitter, and elsewhere. You can rate and review our movies on Amazon and IMDb. You can rate and review the Freedom Fiends and our songs on iTunes. That really helps a lot. You can buy our movies and share them with friends or give them out as gifts. And one of the best ways to spread liberty is to buy a bunch of Freedom Fiends buttons and give them out as gifts. Wholesale prices are available, and you can also comment on our site, or better yet, comment about us on other sites. And please email the site link to all your friends. Thanks for helping spread the Fiends message worldwide to as many liberty people as you can, especially to those who don't yet get it. You rock.
So we're back. So you got more daddy stuff, or can we talk about me?
A little bit.
All right,
okay, so Chris Rock says your job as a daddy is to keep your little girl off the pole. That's half your job. I think the other half your job is to keep your little girl away from the state.
You mean from being a stripper off the pole?
Yeah, that pole. Yeah. Right, right. But I want to keep her away from the state too, man. And I think that's a redemptive thing. I guess you got to talk about a little bit of tyranny to get there. But I know somebody recently who's a little girl who's in public school, and she went to talk to the counselor and said that she was having some self-destructive thoughts. You know, she was pouring her soul out to the counselor, and she got shipped away a city over, not even in Austin. They took her to a mental hospital.
Yeah.
And this is a teenage girl. This is kind of normal stuff. You'd think you'd be able to talk it out. And so I want to keep my little girl out of those public schools, man.
Yeah, and that kind of stuff, you know, I mean, I can see someone thinking, well, that's for their own protection. But it's like those kind of places can make it worse.
Oh, yeah. Can you imagine having a mental health issue, being worried and scared and depressed, and they think it's a good idea to snatch you away from your family and throw you in this place with all these strangers and these bureaucrats and these cops?
I think the fact that they do that makes people less likely to seek help if they need it.
Oh, completely. Yeah, you know? Completely. That and all of this anti-gun mental health stuff, you know, why would you want to go to people who may need legitimate help but don't want to pour out and be completely honest because they're worried the goon squad might come in and raid their home because they might be a threat, or they're worried that they might be a threat and go and snatch their gun safe or take their kids away.
I'll tell you this. I've been kind of delving into this project with this guy on this alternate internet thing. I can't really talk much about it yet, but it's basically something to make the government have less control over what you do on the internet. And it's really making, like, I'm learning things about everything, not just the internet in this, but I really this week have started to really kind of look at the state, like, laughing at it even more than we used to just as normal fiends. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm just kind of like, now when I see stuff, it's really not worrying me. I mean, that could come back, but it's like, you know, I hear about the latest tyranny today, and I'm just like, this is going to fucking collapse like a house of cards. Especially speaking of house of cards.
Oh, yeah.
What did you send me?
Barack Obama was talking to some reporters, and he said, you know, I wish it was more like House of Cards in Washington, which is kind of chilling to somebody like Michael who follows House of Cards and realizes that Kevin Spacey's character, in order to get the power, does some horribly destructive things to the people around him and the people he's vying and measuring their libido dominandi with. And Barack Obama said, yeah, it'd be nice if it worked that way. It reminds me of when Bush said, I wish it were a dictatorship, as long as I'm the dictator.
Yeah. Which is like, I mean, I really, we've said it before, like, they're not even trying to hide the shit anymore. Because, I mean, stuff that when I was a kid in the 70s, like, when officials got caught doing it, they got impeached, is now stuff that's, like, on the official websites of those government organizations, yeah. Mm-hmm. You know? Mm-hmm. And stuff that used to be, like, secret globalist plans to take over everything. It's not like you can go to the UN website and it's on there. They have a, you know, 30-page PDF on their plans to take over the world.
Yeah.
And but it's gone even further than that when you've got Barack Obama saying, like, I want my administration run more like Kevin Spacey's character in House of Cards. Unless he hasn't seen it and he just saw a trailer or someone said, you know, like in his notes, like, make reference to hip Netflix show. Because he's basically, like, Kevin Spacey's character in there is a congressman, for those who haven't seen it or didn't hear our report on it before. He's a congressman who basically gets things done by bribing people, bullying people, blackmailing people, and murdering people.
Right.
Like other congressmen. He murders a fucking congressman with his own hands. Okay?
Yeah. Yeah, Barack Obama would never be brave enough to do something like that.
He'd outsource.
He'll send SEAL Team 6 after you.
Yeah. The outsource. Presidents always outsource it.
Yeah, right. They don't touch the work.
Yeah. I'm not going to call him a homo. I find that really juvenile and offensive and wrong. But
yeah,
I'll call him
stupid
a baby.
I'll
call him a baby killer in a second.
Yeah,
or at least
true.
A teenage killer. Yeah,
it's true, and it's admitted that he's a baby killer. You know, you don't have to do much to prove that.
Yeah.
But calling him a Muslim or calling him a homo, I mean, it's obviously not true. And if it were, it wouldn't be that big of a deal.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I think you're right, man, that the state is grandpa society. I think it's becoming more and more irrelevant. And I think people are starting to see that from all walks of life. We're going to be talking to Chris Novoselic. Novoselic. Yeah, I should know that. I do know that. But one of the guys he's really into, I was reading around on his site, and even pretty lefty people they understand that the system as it is ridiculous. It's horrible. It doesn't work. And they have a different set of solutions that I don't think are very knowledgeable about economics. And I think that that's where their problems come in. But, you know, when they do polls, pretty much everybody, like super majorities of people, say the country's on the wrong track. And now they may think that some people think we need to get top men. Some people think we need to have some kind of community ownership of things. But everybody knows the state, the nation state as it stands today, is an anachronism, and it's on its way out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Did you listen to the pregame recording I did with Chris?
No, I need to. My listening schedule is way off since we had the baby, because I usually listen to podcasts like while I'm at work. You know, that's one of the beauty of podcasts, is you listen to it while you're doing stuff.
Yeah.
But obviously I haven't been at work, and I need to keep an ear on the baby to know if she's okay. So,
I'll give you a summary of it.
All right.
I would like the court record to report that he says in it that. That Kurt Cobain was a huge fan of my band Bomb and shared our music with anybody who would listen to it.
Man, yeah. You lucky bastard.
I know.
That's awesome.
That's like a blessing from the Pope or something.
Yeah,
but he also said that, and he said that Kurt's favorite Bomb song was I Loved You, Then I Died. And he said that Chris also burned a mix CD of Bomb songs and gave them to the bass player in Marilyn Manson, and he fucking loved it.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Man. So Michael got his ego stripped.
I really did. Yeah. I only recorded 11 minutes of like a 40-minute pregame. I did it with his permission just to give to you. He said I could not post it publicly.
Aww.
It's awesome. The Neema cast version 1 of 1. So
That strokes my ego. That makes me feel good.
Yep.
And something Chris Novoselic did just for my ears.
And it starts mid-sentence with like him talking about you being a dad. Like it's all cut off, but then it just comes in like, oh.
Does he have kids?
I don't think so. He has turkeys. They're about the size of a baby.
I'm really curious. Does he know much about Kurt's relationship with Francis Bean?
I told him we're not going to ask about Kurt family stuff, wife and kids. But he's definitely cool with talking about Kurt and with talking about Nirvana. But it's going to be a really wide-ranging interview. He's really funny. He's really low-key. He kind of talks real quiet and like... But he's like, he makes jokes like, I didn't get it at first. I thought he was like about to hang up because he's really sardonic, but like really quiet.
Yeah.
And then he explained, I got it. And then he explained it. And I'm like, okay, he's just got a really dry sense of humor and he's really funny.
Him and Dave Grohl are freaking hilarious. I used to be obsessed with Nirvana and I had all the bootlegs. And Chris Novoselic does some really funny stuff on like their live sets, like in between stuff, doing crosstalk and making fun of hecklers.
Yeah.
There's this thing where this guy is like telling them to play About a Girl. They're at like some club in Europe or something. And the guys don't speak English and they just want to hear like that hit that they heard on the radio. And Chris Novoselic's just like toying with them. He's like, why do you want me to play About a Girl?
Yeah. Do you know about the new? Do you know today Nirvana got inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame today?
Oh,
and they're having a ceremony coming up. Do you know about the new reformed Nirvana?
That sounds
horrible and scary, but it's not like they're really reformed. It's called Sirvana, and it's the three members, Pat and Dave and Chris, with Sir Paul McCartney singing.
Yeah. Well, they played a show like that last year, I think it was. I forget where it was, but they also did like some documentary that Dave Grohl was a big part of, where they got together and played. I think maybe as that group.
Well, Dave Grohl made a documentary about the recording studio where they recorded Nevermind.
That's it.
I listened to Nevermind today in its entirety. Like Chris gave me this whole reading list of like stuff to read about his idea of how to fix democracy, and I'm like, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to go listen to Nirvana Nevermind and the Flipper record Love with Chris playing bass that I've never heard. And I love Flipper.
Yeah.
So
I'll do my research. I did some of the reading on what Chris sent us about his ways of reforming democracy. So you can delegate that to me. I'll talk about that.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I told you. Yeah, it's going to be, the first half is going to be talking about rock and roll. The second half is going to be debating about politics. And we joked that it's going to be like, mostly me asking questions because we were in the same scene. You know, he was much bigger, but we were playing the same clubs when he was playing clubs and knew all the same people. And it's going to be like two old grandpas talking about World War II and then like, oh, my nephew just walked in the room. Let him tell you why you're wrong about everything you fundamentally believe. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
But I disagree. His basic thing is he's got this plan for proportionate representational democracy that's like, he says, even better than what the Knesset has and what the UK parliament has. And you know, to me, it's just, it just sounded like he talked for 15 minutes and I'm just like, I kind of interrupted him and said, that's cool. And I want you to talk about that at length on the interview. But basically, Neema and I are both going to follow that up every time with some variation of like, that's just math on how to redistribute the tyranny. You know, you're not striking the root.
Yeah, yeah.
And he said he's fine with it. He's like, I like good debate and you're respectful and this should be good.
Yeah. Well, I didn't read his stuff yet. I guess I got to do that. I was reading, some guy with a foreign sounding name that he sent me. What's it called? Let's see.
Let me send you his blog.
Gar Alperovich. Yeah,
I don't know who that is. You know, that's one of many people he mentioned in passing. I think you should read his blog, Chris's blog.
Okay, I'll do that.
I'll send you a link.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah,
it's Chris Novoselic. Spelled it correctly. ChrisNovoselic.blogspot.com for anyone out there who wants to look at it.
Okay. I won't do it on the fly.
Yeah.
No. I'll give it some homework while I'm holding Lily while Jessica's taking a break from her milking duties.
Milking duties.
Yeah, man. When you have the baby, it's not the end. It's like the beginning of being a slave to that baby.
For the next 40 years.
Hopefully not that long.
I know. That's how it is in modern society, though.
Sometimes, yeah.
You know, my friend Eddie, on the occasion of his 18th birthday, and he had like another month of high school, on his 18th birthday, his dad gave him a shoe shine kit and kicked him out of the house. and Eddie like finished high school. He finished the last month, like, you know, couch surfing, and then moved to San Francisco and became a bisexual speed freak and then died of AIDS.
So not the best strategy.
Yeah. And was the go-go dancer for my band.
Okay. Well, he had a good run, I guess.
We took him on tour as go-go dancer. I mean, think about like, okay, we're playing like these. Our show, The Freedom Fiends, is on all these radio stations that are like kind of right wing, you know, kind of rural, kind of conservative. Picture my band Bomb, which was freakier than our show, but still like as contrary to conservative whatever. And had a male half nude go-go dancer playing clubs full of people like that sometimes.
Oh, really? You'd have rural conservative people come out to your shows?
No, we almost got killed in Dallas one time.
Oh, wow.
And in Las Vegas.
Well, because they would bill you as hardcore or something like that, and people thought it was like hardcore country western.
Yeah, that happened a few times, too.
Yeah.
But we weren't hardcore. But yeah, that happened. That actually happened.
I'm still not 100% up on the differences between the country-ish genres. I was at a wedding the other day, or I guess it was a month or two ago now. It was in New Braunfels, which is a little rural place south of the Hill Country. It's like where they have Schlitterbahn, and it's kind of a resort-ish town.
I don't know what that is.
Well, I was playing this country song. It was like George Strait or something. And this lady comes up to me. She's like 80 years old or something. She goes, "Do you have any country western?" And I was like, "What am I playing?" You know, I was like, "I just said, well, like who would you like me to play?" And she's like, "Johnny Cash." I was like, "Okay, I'll play some Johnny Cash." But
that would be like, I mean, I know the differences, and that would be like if you were playing, you know, rap music, and someone came up to you and said, "Can you play some rock and roll?" And you know, or some heavy metal, and you're like, "Well, that's what I'm playing."
Is that different?
It's that different to them. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Country Western is actually a combination of two types of music called country and Western. You know, there's that joke in the Blues Brothers. We got both kinds of music, country and Western. That's not ridiculous. That's actually could be something someone would say.
Okay.
The real joke there was just that the Blues Brothers were playing in a country and Western bar.
Right. But they play blues.
But most people who hear that who don't know the difference think the joke is, oh, that lady's so stupid. She's calling country Western country and Western. Mm-hmm. But no, it is a synthesis of two distinct types of music.
Yeah.
And then hardcore country, I believe, like old Johnny Cash, old Hank Williams the First, like,
which is a lot better to my ear and my lyrical sensibilities than the pop country here these days. Because these days they will censor themselves and try to make these funny jokes about their lyrics because they're not saying ass,
yeah,
you know, or some word that Johnny Cash would probably say.
I don't think Johnny Cash ever cussed.
I guess not.
The hardcore in hardcore country usually wasn't cussing. It was usually
murder and sex.
It's murder and sex and cheating on women and shooting cocaine and shooting sheriffs and shooting your wife's lover and going to prison.
Yeah. Well, now they can't even say roll a big fat one on commercial country radio. They'll bleep that out.
Yeah,
there's a Zac Brown Band song where they say, "I'm gonna lay back and roll the big fat one," and they cut the whole line out.
That question about what do you think about that was in all of the extensive research and notes and preparation did for our Hank 3. I'm pretty sure Chris Novoselic is going to show up and is not going to be passed out under a pile of whiskey bottles and tranny hookers when it comes time to do this.
Yeah.
Unlike Hank 3.
Yeah. We had a fan write us and say he was so stoked about that. That's like,
oh, we had like six fans write us, man. You didn't see them all. Yeah.
Okay. I guess I didn't see them all. I've been busy helping to 3D print a human. I sent the file. She did the printing.
You just uploaded the file and then waited 9 months while the layers slowly grew up 3D.
Yeah, exactly, man. Oh, yeah. The other thing about being a dad, man, we went off on the whole meme theory thing, and that's what saves the world. Is everything is just information passing back and forth, and so all we got to do is prove that our information is better. You know that statism is a virus, and you and Kevin McKernan talked about it too. Babies kind of prove that. It's a great microcosm to see that in action, because my wife literally 3D printed a human from nothing but, DNA coded, half of mine, half of hers. And it goes further. Initial breast milk, it's called colostrum. And it actually will give the baby the information the baby's body needs for its immunity. Like the baby comes out, it doesn't know what it's supposed to be immune to. But the mother's body does because it's in that environment. And so the mother's body transfers that info to the babies through the breast milk. It's kind of a mind-blowing kind of thing.
Yeah.
It's like uploading an antivirus file through the boob drive.
The boob drive.
Yeah. Okay. So, you want to get on Jeff Riggenbach, the voice of libertarianism? Yeah.
I want to talk about me.
Let's talk about you.
You bred or something, and we talked about it. I'm kidding. I'm only saying that to piss off the one guy that posted on Facebook saying, like, I really dig the Feens, but I'm thinking more and more Michael Dean thinks he's about to declare himself the leader of the liberty movement. And I'm like, no, man, that's Adam Kokesh. He's the anarchy president, and that's why he's in prison.
He's the anarchy president, yeah. But we totally ripped on Adam Kokesh for that. You never really... I don't know. I don't think we have to worry about Michael doing that.
I'm not a leader. I'm a cheerleader, to quote Timothy Leary.
Ah, there you go.
And I don't mean that I wear a tight skirt and have pigtails. I hear a baby. Is that a baby?
Oh, that must be Lily. That's Lily's first appearance in media.
Why don't you bring her in and poke her and make her make noise?
Oh, I don't want to do that yet.
Okay, but that was, I heard that.
She's still young and delicate.
That was her first, there she is.
Here, I'll open the door a little bit.
Can you bring the mic over? Is there enough cable?
No, they're in the other room. I'm not going to do that. The mic is secure.
We heard it. It was as loud as like when Fuzzy comes in the room and yells on my end. So that was her first official appearance.
There you go.
Yeah.
So you've been trying to get Jeff Riggenbach on the show for a while now. And he apparently, I didn't know that he used to be a radio guy, but I guess that makes complete sense because he's totally got
Jeff
a radio
Riggenbach
voice.
Reading the collected works.
Exactly.
Of Robert Anton Wilson. Yeah.
Yeah. That's where I know him from. I know him from downloading stuff from Mises.org.
He sounds great.
Audiobooks.
I love his. I mean,
oh, yeah.
Yeah. So I got into I thought I was getting into a pod beef with him. And I like totally laid it out what I was thinking with him. And this is kind of a teaching hospital moment of how, like, I really thought he was going to come back and say, well, fuck you. And he came back and said, like, it was the most, he wrote me the most gracious letter I've received in years. It was mind blowing. And it was like, I was kind of, I mean, what I was writing could have been perceived as passive aggressive because I was like, well, you know, he's like, well, why do you want to interview me? And why are you bugging me about this over and over and over? And I like enumerated the reasons like in a way that was completely accurate. But I felt that anybody reading this would either say, fuck you, or be like, well, you think you're special. I don't know. But I don't fuck the motivation or how I thought it would come off more accurately. Let's read back and forth. I'll do his voice because I have a deeper. I don't want to sound like I'm making fun of him.
You want me to do you and you want to do Jeff Riggenbach?
You do Jeff Riggenbach.
Okay.
I'll do me kind of like Beavis. How's that?
All right.
Because, the background on this is I wrote him 4 months ago and said, hey, I got this radio show. It's a libertarian radio show. We'd love to interview you. We dig your stuff. You know, here, can you do it? And like, we wrote back and forth, and he takes like a month to write back generally. You know, he's old school. He's like 67 years old. He smokes a pipe. He's got a beard. He's got gray hair. He looks like, you know, Hemingway, if Hemingway had lived, kind of thing. Very distinguished. He kind of looks like the most interesting man in Liberty, you know, that guy.
Yeah.
And
he looks like he probably has sat in a smoking room with Lou Rockwell, smoking Cuban cigars and drinking fine scotch.
Yeah. So he wrote me, you know, like three once a month for 3 months. Finally wrote me back like a month ago, and he's like, I wrote him when I knew Neema was going to have a baby, and I was trying to book fill-in hosts. And I wrote like 15 people, and like, you know, 8 of them wrote me back within the hour, and I booked them. And they were people I wanted. They weren't just like, you know, it was like people who are good Liberty speakers, and most of them have good mics, and the ones who didn't, like Chris Novoselic, were willing to go buy a mic, and Bill Bupert, and like 4 people went out and bought these Yeti mics, and I helped him set it up. Kevin McKernan did too.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Which is cool because one of my goals in life is to make Liberty Media sound better. So now there's 4 great Liberty talkers out there who have these good mics and can use them. So the next time someone asks to interview them, they'll be like, well, call me on Skype and I'll use my good microphone, you know?
Exactly.
And so Jeff wrote me back like 3 weeks yesterday, 3 weeks after I booked everybody, and I wrote him back. And this is back and forth, my replies to him and his replies back to me. You know, and basically he wrote where this starts is he wrote me and he's like, well, why do you keep writing me? You know, like, why do you keep writing me and asking me to do this? I don't even know if I want to do it. And like, why did you want to interview me in particular? So, he wrote back.
I can't do a Jeff Riggenbach voice. It'll end up sounding more like Jankum Hornberger.
Okay.
He goes, I do these things when I do them because I want to please my fans, one of which I perhaps inaccurately take you to be. Why did you want to interview me anyway?
I'm absolutely a fan of yours. I want to interview you because, in no particular order, I like what you say. I like the sound of your voice. I think you're an important person in the history of libertarianism as well as the present of libertarianism. Most people who do radio and podcast interviews with important people in Liberty these days tend to interview the same new voices over and over. Very few people go to the trouble to talk to the folks who've paved the way, and it usually is more trouble to get the older the OGs to do it, as this experience with you is showing. Honestly, there are 30 people who are bigger names to younger people today who would do an interview at the drop of the hat, and I've interviewed most of them. But I'm more interested in understanding and documenting important historical people who are still around than I am in having the latest hip name as an interview. We're not even an interview show. This is not a situation of gotta fill spots on the calendar. The Freedom Fiends is a two-host show that rarely do interviews. Even an interview that's easy to set up is going to be more work than our usual show. And the older cats are usually harder to get on an interview, but they're usually worth it. The younger folks are a lot easier to get on the phone, and most of them have Skype and a decent USB mic, so they even sound way better than a telephone interview. This is important to us. We're both audio engineers, and we're making this stuff to stick around for 100 years. Phone interviews are pretty unlistenable now and will be considered absolutely unlistenable in the future as decent distance audio becomes more common. But we'll even do a short phoner once in a while if it's topical and easy. The other day on the show, we were talking about Cody Wilson, and we just called him during the show. He was cool with it and went on air and did a 10-minute interview on the spot, even though he was out with his girlfriend shopping for a Christmas tree. But I don't just want to interview the same folks as everyone else. That becomes an echo chamber. And we have a reverence for the past, which I find sorely lacking in the Liberty movement with much of today's new media. And then I quoted... Again,
what I just
with
said,
another
yeah.
line, but read it again because there's...
Okay, sure. I want to please my fans, one of which I perhaps inaccurately take you to be, because why else would you write me 3 times wanting to interview me on your show?
I contacted you 3 times because I'm proactive, because you told me to contact you back, so I did. And because I follow up with people who tell me to follow up with them. If someone says, let's talk in 2 months, I mark it on my calendar and call them in 2 months to the day. I call that keeping my word, but it sounds like I'm coming across as bugging you. Like you, I've got 10 million things on my plate, but I will gladly stop being proactive with you if it's coming across as bugging you.
To be perfectly honest with you, I don't especially want to do any sort of live, spoken off the top of my head type interview with anybody ever.
Understood.
I'm never happy with my performance under such circumstances. I don't put things as clearly and unequivocally as I want to. Just as when I write for the reading eye, I make many revisions before I submit my copy. So I wish I could do the same when I talk off the cuff into a mic. When I was in radio myself, the thing I was worst at was ad-libbing. I could make any copy you handed me sing, but I couldn't speak nearly as well off the top of my head. Of course, I got much better at it when I worked on the air every day, just as I did years later when I was in a classroom 12 hours or more every week. But I've never been happy with my off-the-cuff presentation of much of anything.
I understand well the difference between meditative thought-out grandeur of writing, the meditative thought-out grandeur of writing, which includes editing and rewriting, versus the off-the-cuff nature of live radio. If you told me up front you'd prefer the former to the latter, I wouldn't have bugged you further.
So you tell me whether I should figure on doing this thing in March or whenever.
It sounds like you really don't want to do it and are only willing to do it at this point because you said you would. Let's not do it. I don't think it would be a good interview if it seems like a burden. You do good work, and if writing is your favorite thing, I don't want to push you to do something you don't want to do. Good interviews only come from people who want to be interviewed, and I only want to do good interviews. I will make this a teaching. I will make good teaching hospital use of this whole several month exchange, though. I won't read your name, but I'll say an OG libertarian guy. Oh, later I asked him, and he said it was fine to use his name.
Right.
I'll explain on our Wednesday non-radio podcast show, because we do a lot of what we call the teaching hospital, where we explain to our listeners the ins and outs of audio production, radio podcasting, video, and news gathering. And there's a lesson in here about taking cues from people one contacts about an interview or anything and not wasting time and energy with things that are going to be like pulling teeth. We do the teaching hospital segments because one of my main goals with the show, our main goals with the show, is to eventually replace ourselves. We want to encourage a few hundred people to be able to do what we do in their own style and voice and with the quality we do it. So when we can't do it anymore for one reason or another, we've helped the next generation. Thank you.
So awesome.
We didn't get to his reply. I don't even know if it's in here.
No, I have it. Do you want me to forward it back to you? You sent it back to me. It was called Jeff Riggenbach's awesome reply.
Yeah.
To me.
Yeah. Let's read that.
All right. Let me try to forward that to you here.
Yeah.
Here we go. I got it. So yeah, but let's comment on that a little bit. Do you want to before we get into the reply?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. When you sent that to me, I was just like, you know, that's why Michael gets the best interviews. That's why people in the Liberty Movement always say about you that, you know, you can get anybody you want.
Oh, and
you say, you know that about yourself.
And a lot of it too is like the back and forth. Like, you know, it's not that hard to get someone to say, yeah, I'll do it. But then to get them to really want to do it and do it good. Like Chris Novoselic originally said, yeah, I'll do like an hour or whatever. But after talking to him last night, he's like, yeah, I'll probably do the whole show, both 2 hours.
Right,
so,
right.
And he's really excited about it. And he'll probably show up. Unlike I never got a chance to talk to Hank III, who, you know, was under a pile of whiskey bottles and tranny hookers.
Right. But, you know, the thing is, this shows perfectly how honest you are with the people you want to get on the show. You broke it down for them. You said what exactly you're doing. You said it's not an interview show. We're not just trying to fill time. This is why I like you. This is why I think you'd be good for the show. If you're not really that into it, fine, I'll move on. You know, you were completely honest. You weren't a fanboy. You weren't begging. You were just saying, hey, this is the thing we're trying to get accomplished here. You're a part of that if you want to be. If not, no big deal. And Jeff Riggenbach actually responded, and his response, he basically says, man, good job. Good show, old boy. And then and I guess we'll go ahead and read some of his response here. And there's quotes of yours, so I guess you can go through and read your parts again. All right. So he says, Michael, or is it Mike? I guess you should tell him it's Michael.
I did.
Okay, good. He says, thank you for your candor. I'll be equally candid in reply. And then you quote, it's your quote.
It's just the thing about why I want to interview him, the three years since I've seen him.
And he says, thank you. This is exactly what I want to hear from those who contact me after encountering my writing or my audio work or both. I don't usually get it in such a pure, unrefined form, and I thank you doubly.
I will say, I was really, I rewrote these and checked them and like made sure there were no typos in them or very few typos in them and like really worked on my words. I spent like a half hour, an hour on each of these replies because he's a really smart, literate guy. And I figured like with most people, I do that anyway, but I really took like an extra pass or two because I really felt like he wouldn't put up with any bullshit of like putting IT apostrophe S when you met ITS. I think he would notice it and be like, it would knock you down a notch with him, you know?
Yeah. It's your quote again.
It's about most people who do podcast and radio interviews. Oh, about the same voices over and over and over.
Right.
And how much easier, you know, how much easier it is to get Amanda Billy Rock on the phone than him.
Right. Basically. Right. And he says, I honestly didn't mean to be troublesome. I hope to get our ongoing conversation on a more candid, even blunt footing. That's the way I prefer it. So there is minimal misunderstanding. So he says right there that, you know, the fact that you came at me with true honesty is what I had wanted. That's what Jeff Riggenbach wanted. And so he's starting to open up back to you since you opened up to him.
Yeah.
Yep.
And then there's my thing about the 30 people I could get on the drop of a hat who, you know, would look better in Google searches or whatever.
Yeah, but you're more interested in understanding and documenting important historical people who are still around. I don't know. I almost thought when he was going to read the reply or reply to your reply that he'd be kind of offended that you called him a historical person. But he says, again, you say exactly what I want to hear, and you express an attitude towards the importance of the past and of intellectual predecessors that I hope is widespread among younger libertarians.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then he requotes your part about how we're not even an interview show. And he says, oh, well, I had assumed it was. Thanks for the correction. That again, helps him to understand the nature of the beast and that he's more than just something that somebody suggested to us. And so he's a check on a checklist that we're just marking off. And then let's see. Yeah.
Then there's my part about, you know, the younger folks are easier to get and they usually have a USB mic and it sounds better. And we're doing this for the future to stick around in 100 years.
The future. Yes. He says, I have Skype, but I've never used it, and I can get a decent USB mic by March or so, if not before. My wife, who is my audio engineer as well as my wife, I'm just brainless talent like Ted Baxter on the old Mary Tyler Moore show, is out of town for a few days at the moment, but I'm confident the two of you can get together via email and determine what mic I should have.
Oh, and I answered this part with just, oh, if you want to spend $60, get this mic. If you want to spend $100, get this mic. Then contact me and I'll help you set it up. I do it for people all the time. Excellent. Ted Baxter, Mary Tyler Moore was an old workplace comedy in the 70s that took place in a TV station. Mm. You'd like it. Well, you'd probably hate it, but it's you'd recognize every character in it. And Ted Baxter is the seasoned, gray-haired, good-looking, like, hi, I'm on television, ladies.
The guy that keeps a cigar in his mouth all the time when he's not on set.
Yeah, and like, you know, could never do journalism or research to save his life, but is stunning at reading from cue cards, which is what they had instead of a teleprompter.
Oh, before teleprompters. Yeah, oh, wow. You know, that would suck.
Basically, he's a blow-dried, good-looking, older, talking head. That's what Ted Baxter is. And he's making...
Okay.
Jeff's making a joke here saying, like, you know, I'm not that good on the fly, but hey, I'm like Ted Baxter if you give me a script.
Yes. I think he's being a little bit humble there.
Yeah, he is. Because his articles are great. I mean, he's written for, like, the New York Times, Reason, you know, Lou Rockwell, a whole bunch of mainstream magazines too, like Washington Post, I think.
All right. He says, after you get the mic, or he gets the mic, he says, it'll be just a matter of time training me to use it. In the old days, I found running an audio board and doing a radio show no more complicated than driving a car, but just as I needed a mechanic if the slightest thing went wrong with my car, so I needed and still need an engineer if the slightest thing won't work properly about my audio equipment. I thought phone interviews were terrible 40 years ago, and I'm glad it's possible now to get better audio than that without paying for a T1 line.
Which I wrote him back and said, T1 line has been replaced, you know, an ISDN line has been replaced by a Comrex and explained what that was. But, you know, let's take a break here, go to the market. Right. I know we're in the middle of this, but
This is Michael Dean from the Freedom Fiends. Federal Reserve notes only have value because of a collective hallucination, whereas gold and silver are real, and so is their value. Gold and silver predate government-printed funny money, and they will undoubtedly outlive government-printed funny money. Get some gold and silver into your hands from Midas Resources by going to freedomfiends.com right now and clicking on the Midas Resources banner over on the right. Or go to gold.freedomfiends.com. That's gold.freedomfiends.com. Admit it. You hate shopping for Christmas. You do. It's a hassle coupled with a burden, mechanically checking off friends, relatives, and coworkers from your list. You're probably not even religious, but if you are, is buying your cousin some little made-in-China piece of plastic really celebrating the birth of your savior? This holiday season, why buy gifts for friends and relatives? Most of them are status anyway. You should send that money to the Freedom Fiends instead. The Freedom Fiends will use your money to help spread education of horizontal liberation throughout the world. If you want to help provide inoculation from indoctrination, go to freedomfiends.com and click on the spinning coin on any post to send your money to the Fiends instead. Because buying crap for unappreciative statist relatives won't get your name on the golden floppy disk of redemption. And if you must shop for Christmas, please do it through the Freedom Fiends Amazon link over on the right side of freedomfiends.com. It won't cost you anything extra, and Amazon will save you the danger of holiday drive-by stabbings at your local mall. Amazon pretty much sells everything you can buy on this earth, except for guns and weed. But they do sell the DVD Guns and Weed: The Road to Freedom, so get that for your gun-hating stoner brother or neocon gun nut dad. They'll thank you for it. That's freedomfiends.com.
Creamy Radio Audio. Want caviar sound on a cat food budget? Creamy Radio Audio by the Freedom Fiends has great free tips so you can sound like a pro without spending like one. The most powerful form of human communication is one person speaking to another. But if people have to suffer through your sound, they'll change the channel and miss your message. With articles on microphones, preamps, recorders, mastering, recording remotely over the internet, doing a podcast, even getting a show on actual radio, the Freedom Fiends show you what they use and where to get it. Whether you're a talk show host, voiceover artist, podcaster, evangelist, or just want to record your loved ones for the ages, at Creamy Radio Audio, the Freedom Fiends will help you make the most of your sound. Creamy Radio Audio will help you speak to the world with sound that will make people want to keep listening. Check out creamyradioaudio.com. That's creamyradioaudio.com.
Hey, this is Squisscar Squig Elves from Death Clocks. And you are listening to the Freedoms Fiends on the, you know, the radios. And I guess it says worms now. So there you go.
When you shop online, please do it through the Freedom Fiends Amazon link over on the right side of freedomfiends.com. It won't cost you any extra, and the Fiends will get a little taste from Amazon, and Amazon will save you the danger of drive-by stabbings at your local mall. Amazon sells pretty much everything you can buy on this earth, except for guns and weed. But they do sell the DVD Guns and Weed: The Road to Freedom. So get that for your gun-hating stoner brother or neocon gun nut dad. They'll thank you for it. That's freedomfiends.com. Freedom, Foxtrot, Echo, Echo, November, Sierra.com.
Hi, I'm Michael Dean from the Freedom Fiends, and like you, I'm concerned with privacy on the internet. The electronic police state is strangling our previous protections, and the central scrutinizer is trying to squint into all areas of our lives. That's why smart people surf the net with a VPN or virtual private network. I use a VPN from Bola VPN. Bola VPN has your utmost security in mind and will allow you to surf, email, and do other computing tasks without leaving a trail of breadcrumbs across the internet. Unlike many other VPN providers, Bola VPN doesn't log traffic. With Bola VPN, you can change your apparent location or disappear completely. Bola VPN has been around since 2007, which is OG in the VPN world. Bola VPN is easy to install and configure. Best of all, it can be had for less than 25 cents a day, which is a small price to pay for this much security. And if you open a support ticket saying you heard about them through the Freedom Fiends, they'll add 3 extra days free. That's Bola VPN at BOLEHVPN.net.
And we're reading from this reply from Jeff Riggenbach, and we were in the middle of the line. So go ahead, Neema.
Yeah, well, I just wanted to comment on his comment about how running the microphone is like running a car, but he needs a mechanic. I'm glad and thankful that both you and I are the engineer and the drivers of our various audio cars. I think it makes things a bit easier.
Yeah, it never really crossed my mind what it would be like if it wasn't like that. But I'm kind of wondering if we'd have a show if only one of us could do this.
Right.
You know,
right.
I mean, I really, from a distance, like if you knew it and I didn't and you were having to walk, it wouldn't happen. It might happen if you didn't know it and I knew it, because I would have time to walk you through it. You wouldn't have time to walk me through it, even though there'd be the same amount on the phone. But, you know, you wouldn't have time to research, like, the mixer you need and the
right,
how to set it up and talk to Ian and do all the work I did. So, yeah, yes. We wouldn't have a show, I think, if we weren't both engineers.
Yeah.
And so it sounds great.
Thank God for that.
Thank all you right, for your service, Neema.
Thank you for your service, Michael. So,
I mean, that's, also, I kind of think that's the nature of the world now, is like people who can only do one thing really well aren't nearly as employable as people who can do 30 things kind of well.
Jeff Tucker might argue with you on that. But
it depends. But at least in like running your own business, I would say. Although it's kind of been like that with running your own business. Like my dad always said, you know, I wear many hats at my job because I work for myself.
Yeah, yeah. I think you have to be able to, but I think specialization is not obsolete. And it's I don't think it ever will be. I don't think it's
I've
like
heard
that.
I've heard specialization is for insects. I think that's Bill Bupert's sig line in his emails.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a quote from
Heinlein, acquiring
as
many skills as you can does help you. But I think the law of comparative advantage says that even if you're the best at everything, you still need to work and cooperate with other people. That way, everybody can be better off.
Not me. I'm an avid indoorsman. I only cooperate with myself.
That's not true, man. I know. That's not true. Part of what you do all day, every day is contact people to cooperate. Yeah, exactly.
I contact people and say, do my bidding. Buy my book.
Exactly.
All right, so go on.
All right. Riggenbach says, needless to say, your desire to do quality oral history. Oh, I loved it when he said that line. This is an aside here. Oral history. We've never put the show that way, but you know, there is an oral tradition, I think, that's becoming revitalized through podcasting and radio.
I've always, you know, when I was a kid, I used to go to the library and listen to the Smithsonian Institute recordings. Like, you know, records, you know, they had copies, they had a series of like records of, you know, like bird songs of the Amazon and like folk songs of Appalachia. And I was like, even though it was done through a government program, it was like, I really dug the, I didn't care back then, but you know, I still could think it's kind of neat. Like, and somebody now that gets done anyway, all the time. And like Jeff Riggenbach is doing it with Liberty. Like he reads, you know, the works.
Yeah.
He does the audiobooks of Mises and stuff for the Mises Institute.
Right.
And have everybody.
And it reminds me of Dan Carlin. He always, I guess his big advertiser is audible.com. And so at the end of every show, he does like a pitch for them. And in one of his pitches, he says, you know, he's starting to think that literature is actually flourishing more than maybe ever it has before because of things like audiobooks and podcasting, because people are able to do that in their busy lives and consume so much more media than if they were stuck to having to sit at a desk and actually use their eyes to read something.
You know, reading in a way is kind of a luxury of the affluent.
Right.
It's never really been for the common man, which is why there's not a lot of literature for the common man, which is why Selby had a hard time selling his books, a hard time making a living, and, you know, was like kind of condemned because he wrote about the common man, but it was kind of a little more literary than that, but you know, his books were like for the people too. Mm-hmm, and it's not that common for books, but it's common for other media.
But these days, everybody, every working class dude, anybody in the world has their chromed robot turd or their iPod Nano or something. You know, I work out in the field just about every day. I mean, not now because I'm taking care of little Lily. But every day, just about everybody you see has, you know, audio cables around their neck. You know, they've got their earbuds hanging draped around their neck. And they're listening probably to a lot of them to music, but I think a lot of them listen to podcasts and audiobooks too. Because how can you not? You know, and I think that because of that, that flourishing of the transfer of information, that's another thing we have on our side here as radio personalities and podcasters.
You know, when I started doing podcasting in 2006, which was pretty soon after podcasting really existed, there wasn't much adoption for it. And there was like, you know, podcasters, I was in some kind of podcast like Yahoo groups, you know, that was social networking back then. And like, you know, we were trying to figure out how to do it. And I remember like when audible.com started, a bunch of podcasters like, oh, fuck that, that's selling out. And I was like, no, man, that's going to make it so everybody knows how to use a podcast, and then they'll listen to yours maybe, you know?
Yeah.
Like, people don't get that the common denominator drives the adoption of the ability to have a market for the weird and segmented.
Right, right. Like, making new cryptocurrency will actually help everybody.
Yeah, and Jeff, you know, Jeff, maybe the fact that I got Jeff to look into buying a USB mic, and I'm going to help him do it, maybe he can do a lot more audiobooks, because I think he goes into a studio to do those.
That's what it sounds like.
Yeah, he doesn't do them at home. Like, if he doesn't know what he's doing, and or maybe his wife records them on reel-to-reel and mails them off to Mises, and some student at Mises digitizes them.
Yes,
I wouldn't be surprised.
All right. So I'll go back to Riggenbach. He says, needless to say, your desire to do quality oral history on the libertarian movement of our time is enormously gratifying to me. When you write that you, quote, have a reverence for the past, which I find sorely lacking in the liberty movement with much of today's new media, I am hopelessly won over to your cause. Your contacting me three times before now does not come across as bugging me. Normally, I tell people like you, that is people who write me on the basis of having read me or listened to me and want something from me, that the only way they'll get what they're looking for is to stay after me, keep reminding me relentlessly, etc. I am almost always willing to do what they want, but in my own time, which I can't always predict accurately. I appreciate it when I tell people to recontact me and they actually do. I appreciate your keeping your word. But at the same time, I kind of hoped that the whole while that you'd forget about it and go away, because I don't like doing live audio or video interviews. Now, I'm glad you didn't go away.
First of all, I have to interject here. First of all, I think we should not do him on the radio. I think we should interview him on a Wednesday cast or another time and play
take
it on the
edge
radio.
Off.
Yeah.
Sure.
Secondly, this is really funny, because I thought this was going to be a teaching hospital of like, don't keep bugging people and waste your time on people who don't immediately jump to do what you're asking them to do. That was going to be my teaching hospital, but it turned the complete opposite of kind of feel out whether maybe you should keep doing it or ask the right questions or tell them more information.
Oh, yeah.
You know.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Because I think we all suffer from that we can kind of go to nuclear, I guess, when we try to contact somebody and it feels like they're blowing us off. But sometimes they're just busy or there's something and you didn't really get them to open up to you. Maybe keep up after them a couple of times. Maybe write an email like Michael wrote.
It's kind of I wouldn't say a dance, that sounds dishonest, but it's kind of an interaction, not an event, with some people. Like, the length of my reply to him here, if I'd sent that to him in his first email, he would have thought, too long, didn't read, delete it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But I probably didn't put enough information up front. You know, to me, like, contacting someone who's a libertarian, who used to be a mainstream radio voice personality, and saying, hey, libertarian stuff is actually on radio now, would you like to come be on our radio? That's pretty much what my first pitch was. I thought that would be enough, but, you know, I should have started with, and I have great reverence for you, and I want to preserve, like, the free market Smithsonian, which sounds cheesy, but that's really what I want to do with a lot of this. I mean, you look at the movies I've done, like, I interviewed Hubert Selby 3 months before he died. I'm not saying Riggenbach's going to die, but I'm saying, like, you want to get what I will say is, I think a lot of the interviews I've done, whether they've been movie, video, whatever, internet video or podcast or radio, a lot of the interviews I've done with people kind of become one of the canonical the like go-to interviews for that person. You know, if you search interview with Larkin Rose, like, we come up, you know, you search, you know, mood, like, documentary with Hubert Selby, I come up. If you search, you know, I can't even name them all, but I've done
Cody
so many
Wilson.
Interviews. Cody Wilson. Oh, yeah. If you search interview with Cody Wilson, you know, audio interview with Cody Wilson, we're going to be the first or one of the first things that comes up. If you search the guy from Death Clock, if you search Brandon Small. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we're one of the first things that comes up. I mean, we kind of become the go-to interview with people, and it's because we take care with it, we prep with it, it's good audio, we don't ask the usual questions, and,
right.
You know.
Yeah. Well, one of the things I learned doing journalism is there's different ways to approach interviewees, and some interviewees, they require you to say what their place is in your story, you know, what they're there for. Otherwise, they're not going to really think or respect you enough to come back to you to actually respond. They think that you're just lazy trying to fill the slots in their interview show like Jeff Riggenbach had thought originally.
Right.
So coming up and dropping the science of what your scientific method is going to be can be helpful with certain interviewees, and it definitely helped here with Mr. Riggenbach.
Yep. So let's not read the rest of this because there's other stories of redemption to talk about here, but this just goes on with, read the thing at the end about OG libertarian though. That's pretty good.
Oh yes. Yeah. I love being called a quote OG libertarian, and I have no objection to your using me as a case in point on your quote teaching hospital, but now I would like to appear on your show. I love that he knows what that means. Apparently.
I wonder if he had to look it up. Claire Wolf had to look it up, and then she loved
it.
Yeah,
did
when
she?
I called her an OG libertarian.
Okay.
You know, I say an OG libertarian, initially it was somebody who paved the way, but you've kind of expanded it to anybody who, and that's what it is what I'm saying here, but you've also, I like that you've included it to mean anyone who became a libertarian before you could do it with the internet, where you had to go to the library or go to faxes or go to meetings.
Right. Or wait for that newsletter or write that newsletter.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah. Worms.
So, Worms, Jeff Riggenbach, great guy. I love this whole thing, man. It's just made my day.
Yeah.
I sent him buttons, too. He lives in Houston. He used to live in San Francisco.
I think he'll like the buy sheep, for sheep, on sheep.
You know, Karmaceuticals in, the
Denver.
The place that we filmed the pot part of the pot and weed movie, they just ordered 90. GunsAndWeed.com buttons from us and 90 buy sheep, for sheep, on sheep buttons from us.
That's great.
Yep.
They got it doesn't today. Surprise they me at all today. That they ordered the GunsAndWeed.com, but I'm stuck that they ordered the buy sheep. Yeah,
I don't know if they, you know, I never talked to them about what it means. Maybe he got it. He's a smart guy, but it doesn't seem like something, you know, I think people there would like the shrimp, the Anarchy Gumbo shrimp better or something. Like,
why? Because they're stoned?
I don't know. Yeah, because shrimp are, well, maybe, yeah, shrimp.
Shrimp are tasty. Gumbo's tasty.
So are little lambs, sheep.
They are.
It is cute, though. People like cute things when they're stoned.
Yeah.
I don't know. Maybe he gets it, but yeah.
I think Austin probably gets it.
Yeah, he gets it.
That wouldn't surprise me at all.
Yep.
All right.
Yep. So, yeah, moving on. I want to talk about this thing that Ian Freeman did that was mind-blowing to me.
All right. The speech for the state children.
Yeah.
The children of the state.
I will link this video in the show notes. Ian and Mark Warden, I think is the guy's name. He's the porcupine realty.
Yeah, the realtor Mark Warden. He's the realtor Mark Warden.
Yeah.
No, he changed it.
And he's also a state rep in New Hampshire. They have like 15.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, they have like 50. Well,
they got something Chris Novoselic would be, or Novoselic would be proud of.
Yeah, they probably, Their state rep house is the second largest in the world, next to like India's parliament or something.
Wow.
New Hampshire state house has like 300 members, but like 15, and they each represent like 27 people. I don't know, like a few, you know, 1,000 people or 5,000 people or something.
But, much closer to the spirit of what it was supposed to be.
In
the crucible of the founding.
It kind of reminds me of that, the Simpsons, where they go to Australia and like Bart makes a, after Bart makes a collect long distance call and some little kid in Australia answers it and leaves it off the hook for 6 hours because Bart wants to find out if the toilet's flush the other way down there. And, you know, the guy gets, his dad gets this bill for $900 dues and he says, this is an outrage. I'm going to go all the way to my my member of parliament, and you see him running over a hill and dale, and you think he's gonna, like, it's gonna go on for days, and he's gonna get to the city and take a train, and no, but he just runs over like the end of his field, goes to a pond where there's a naked fat guy in an inner tube drinking a Foster's, and he goes, "Hey, Andy, I got something to report to you." He goes, "I'm gonna report this to my member of parliament."
Yeah. No, that's not a member of parliament. It's actually a member of parliament.
No, what it is he says, "I'm going to report this to my member of parliament." And he turns and says to the guy across the fence who's tending his pigs, "Hey, Andy, I got something to report to you." And he shows him the letter and he's like, "This is an outrage. We're taking this to the prime minister." And then they run like four blocks and find
the fat guy in the inner tube is the prime minister.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah,
good times.
But yeah, so it's Mark Warden and Ian, and who's the guy that's a co-host sometimes that's got the big bushy fro? I forget his name, but
Daryl.
Yeah, Daryl. So he's like 19. So these three dudes, Ian and Daryl and Mark Warden, got invited by a teacher to speak at an assembly of high school students at the Keene High School, the state school. You know, the high school there.
Wow,
it was mind blowing. I mean, I watched this thing. It was 45 minutes long. They didn't show the kids. You could hear them, but, you know, they probably, for privacy issues, didn't film the kids. But
yeah, kids have to get waivers or something like that.
It was mind-blowing, though, to me. I mean, like, the content of it, like, if this was them, those three guys speaking at Porkfest, I'd be like, yawn and click out after 4 minutes. And I'm not saying anything bad about it, but it was so libertarianism 101, and it was like, you know, they weren't nervous, but they were like, there wasn't a lot of feedback from the kids at first. You know, they didn't clap at fun. A couple of them would laugh at jokes and like, but the fact that they were speaking at a state school blew my mind. I mean, it'd be like, I picture kids coming home from that and being like, "Billy, what'd you learn in school today? That I shouldn't trust the government and that police are out to get me and that voting doesn't change anything and that I should drop out of school right now and homeschool myself on the internet."
That's great.
Yeah.
Yeah. It'd be like if instead of putting in the educational video in the VHS player, the teacher just clicked on the YouTube of one of the Feens episodes.
Yeah.
Yeah. The Feens interview with Larkin Rose or something.
And like left to go to the teacher's lounge and drink red wine.
Right. Yeah. Vodka, I think.
But it really touched me, man. And I wrote Ian an email about it. And I said, and he didn't write back, but, you know, he just wrote back about some other stuff. And we were in another ongoing conversation. I said, "I watched your entire video last night of you guys speaking about liberty at that local high school assembly. That was amazing. I really love how you put yourself out there. You're the opposite of me. I'm an avid indoorsman." Wow.
Did you come up with that on a recent show?
Yeah, I came up with that when you were gone.
Okay. That's funny.
Apparently, it's not original. Like, you can actually buy t-shirts that say that, but it so fits me. I came up with it while talking, like, while doing the intro for Scott Horton. It just came out.
Okay.
While I, like you, have no trouble speaking in front of crowds of people in person, I no longer seek it out. I avoid it. And you're a guy who has his phone number on your website for anyone to contact you because you see it as an opportunity to be of service and talk liberty with people or to help people in any way. Whereas I freak out and call you whining because some earnest guy from a nutbag radio show somehow got my number and called me asking for advice." Because the guy called Ian, too, so I wanted to know it. Okay. And Ian was like, yeah, the guy sounded like a politician. He was trying to like say, "Oh, we don't really believe those things." But, you know, Ian just gave him some like general advice on calling radio stations and got off the phone. I said, "I have about 50 people blocked on email. I'd venture to guess that you have no one blocked. I used to be way more open to the world like you, but I sort of took in too much from too many people in the first 30 years of my life. So more and more, I want to be left alone, yet still speak to the world. I find that comforting. My windowless bunker with windows is a glorious place. I don't think I need to change, but I wanted to say I really dig that you are the way you are with humans. It's a beautiful thing. Very zen, but it's street zen, not monastery zen.
Yeah.
Have you seen my documentary about Hubert Selby Jr.? Link. A recurring theme in the film is that Selby and his friends talked a lot about how Selby always said yes to life, and that was his phrase. A small example of that is that even though he was famous, he was listed in the Los Angeles phone book. And when strangers called, he'd make time for them." And yeah, that's pretty much it.
Yeah, yeah. It is really amazing what Ian does. And I guess he should get some more props here for that. So here for Ian.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I really like that say yes to life thing. Like, you know, Selby was like that. Like, you know, if someone said like, "Hey, will you come speak at this AA meeting, you know, 110 miles away for no gas money, he'd be like, okay, I'll do it. You know, and, you know, he actually taught at USC. He taught English as an adjunct professor. And he was going and teaching his class, like, until 3 weeks before he died, like, on his oxygen tank when he probably should have been in a hospital or at least home, you know?
And I think that kind of attitude, especially for somebody like Ian and people in the Liberty movement, they should take note of that. People in the Liberty mission, I should say, is, you know, people are going to judge us a lot by our demeanor. And if we give them fodder for their tirades against the libertarians, then they're going to pick up on that, on the bad, nasty things. But if we're so pure that we're like Ian and we're like Zen monks going on the street and giving people all the advice and help and love and passion that we have, and I'm not saying everybody should do it, but it's great when people are out there like that, giving the Liberty Mission a good name, that, hey man, we're just people out there trying to further the cause of actual peace. You know, that's all we're trying to do here, is help educate people about peace. We're not trying to pursue some kind of political agenda where people need to render us money so we can lay and collect taxes. We're just trying to teach about peace.
Yeah. So moving on to Redemption 3 of 3 in the third act, I'm going to send you an email right now, and I want us to read it. It's basically, I was going to read this Saturday, but I think we're going to have a full 2 hours with Chris, and he doesn't need to hear me make amends on the air to someone he doesn't know. So, yo, I'm going to just send you this and say, yo. So
yow.
Basically, this is an apology to the guy who did Jamie, who did the Voluntarist comic, because about a year ago when he was crowdfunding for this, I bashed him on the air for it. I said, man, go get a job. I did, you know, like, don't ask. And I was complaining about crowdfunding in general. I was saying, like, that's just, you know, automating cyber begging. And I actually talked about how I had cyber begged to make my first movie. But it was like, it wasn't something you could just go to a site and do. And I feel like since I had to actually, you know, put a PayPal link on my site, and I was one of the first people to do that, to the point where a newspaper in Toronto or in Vancouver wrote a big article about me, about my movie, because I was showing it there. And they said, like, Michael Dean has a PayPal link on his website for his movie, DIY or Die, How to Survive as an Independent Artist. For most filmmakers, admitting to being broke would be paramount to calling yourself a failure. But this is such a plucky little movie about doing what you do no matter what, that it kind of makes sense and kind of helps his cause. Like, they actually had to, like, find a reason that it was okay for me to have a PayPal link saying, please donate. Like, I was an OG and begging money on the internet from strangers.
Right, right.
And, like, I guess I thought that since I did it the hard way, now that there's an easy way, that's the wrong way. And I was wrong about that, first of all. And second of all, I really didn't get the libertarianism of it, because it's completely the opposite of, like, forced charity. You know, it's, hey, yeah, these people fund this, these people fund this. If you don't want to fund it, you don't fund it. And Cody Wilson's success with it really made me, like, you know, the printable gun wouldn't have happened without crowdfunding. So
yeah. It's like when you're a little kid and you're soliciting money to eat the worm. Like, I'll eat the worm if I can raise up $10 to eat the worm. You know, nothing wrong with that.
I'll get in trouble with the federal government and have laws passed against me in Congress for $10. That's what Cody did. So right, why don't you go ahead and read his and mine, since I'm getting a sore throat and you haven't been on the radio much lately. So
yeah. This is your apology. Jamie, I apologize for taking you to task for crowdfunding your comic. And I see that your comic has come out, and I'm glad. I've had a really good track record in my life with understanding the importance of emerging technologies, but I've missed the mark completely on two of them. One was YouTube, if you can believe that. When it came out, I told people, quote, don't put your videos on someone else's site, put them on your own site, end quote. I didn't get how important and universal YouTube was going to become. I also didn't grok at first how very libertarian crowdfunding is. It's literally the opposite of the government. At first, it seemed to me to just be an automated panhandling. Part of that perception was because I was getting a lot of spam from people I used to know when I lived in San Francisco who were trying to crowdfund, quote, social justice crap. But now I see crowdfunding as an example of how things could be in a non-coercive world. If you'd like to call in our radio show sometime, I'd put you on for a segment to talk about what you're doing, and I will also apologize to you in public. Let me know if you want to call, and I'll let you know what days we don't already have a guest. Sorry I said dumb stuff about you, and I wish you the best. I love that last line. Sorry I said dumb stuff about you. Yes, Michael's making amends. That's one of the great things about Michael, is he's internalized that when he's realizes he's wrong, he will actively make actual amends, which is what you're doing here. Good job.
Yeah, and amends, again, doesn't just mean an apology. It right. means mending it. It means making up for the wrong that you did. And, you know, to me, part of that isn't just an apology in an email to him. It's like an invitation to come on the show and,
yeah.
you know, spend as much time talking up his project as I spent talking it down, basically. So.
It's interpersonal restorative justice. There you go. I think part yeah. of it is what we're doing right now and talking about it on the
show. Yeah, and this is just like... the reason I'm reading this now instead of waiting to do it all on the air with him is like he's busy and we're busy booked up with guests. Like, I don't want to interrupt Chris Novoselic and say, hey, we're going to have this guy come on for 5 minutes you've never heard and talk about something you don't know anything about, you know?
right.
And because you're going to be on Sundays and
Saturdays,
but, but you know, you're going to want to like talk because you're not on enough. And I did tell him, like, if you need to, we'll make it happen before then. But I basically said, let's try to do this in March. So read his reply, please.
Yeah. He says, hello, Michael. I appreciate your apology. It's not easy to own up to past misstatements and move forward. But I think that the Liberty Movement has a great basis, self-reflection in the philosophy of liberty. So thank you for rethinking your position. I really appreciate it, and I appreciate your quick reply. I agree that crowdsourcing is a beautiful demonstration of what non-coercive solutions to common problems can be. It has literally taken the world by storm. People around the globe are watching just how easy it is to help others when the government is not involved, from cancer treatments to hoodies for the homeless. I'm a bit loaded with Christmas coming, but let me know what times you do your show. I love talking about liberty and encouraging others to use their talents.
Yeah. So I wrote him back and forth a couple more times and we figured we'd do it in March. So I was really happy that I came around on that and that it was kind of hard to find his email address because I can't spell, he doesn't have it as a link. It's an image and you have to type it. And I can't spell voluntary. And I spelled it wrong twice, and it got kicked back. And I'm like, okay,
yeah,
fix this for me, internet. Yeah,
yeah, yeah. I think it's shows strength of character to revise past things that were wrong, rather than to stick to them just so you don't look like you were wrong at some point.
Yeah.
I think that kind of honesty and candor is just as important as the kind you demonstrated when you emailed Jeff Riggenbach. Because if people don't think you're an honest broker, then they're not going to want to listen to you in the first place. And I think if you show by example that, hey, man, I was wrong about that one thing. Then it helps people to understand that, oh, this is the kind of guy that's going to realize when he's wrong and is going to try to correct it.
Thank you. And that's the end of the redemption in the third act. And now we'll go into the denouement. Yeah, which is me putting you on the spot in public about when we're going to add an extra hour to the Freedom Fiends. Because read this note that I just got from John Harmon at GCN today, being really excited about the Chris Novoselic interview because he's a big fan.
Oh, yeah. Also, as a side note, when did you want to launch?
No, above that it says, the interview, the interview. I'm excited. Regarding the interview, I'm excited.
Okay.
It was on the wrong line, so.
The interview. I'm excited. That part?
Okay, yes.
I read that. And the rest of it, too?
Yeah.
All right. Also, as a side note, when did you want to launch the third hour? January, February, we spoke about it. I spoke with the staff about it. It seems like a no-brainer. Just keep me posted as to when you could do an additional hour, and I can aim for that on this end.
Okay, and here's my reply to him. You can read this. What?
Oh, okay. I thought you were asking for me. Okay.
No.
Howdy, John. I'm glad you're psyched about the possibility of a third hour of Feens each week. If it were up to just me, I would do it starting this weekend, but Neema has a 5-day-old baby, so it's not a good time for me to ask him.
Good time for me to ask him on the air tonight, though.
Yeah, good point. I have it on my calendar to ask him at the end of January about starting it in the end of February. FYI, for now, we're only thinking of doing it for Saturday, not for Sunday. Thanks.
That was correct, right? Saturday was your preferred day if we were going to do
my preferred day. Yes, definitely.
So I'm not – I guess I'm –
I'm crowdfunding the idea of Feens pressuring you to think that's a good idea.
Oh,
hours on Saturday.
We'll see what the Feens
2 hours
say.
On Sunday. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm not opposed to it, but
and I could fill in when you can't do it too.
Okay.
I could just take calls or have a guest or something. So
have Jeff Riggenbach do it,
or just read from my many papers and documents.
Yes.
I'll be like, well, let's see. It's hour three of the Feens on Saturday. Let's see. Here's a letter to the editor I wrote in 1989 complaining about the...
read old newsletters from the Future of Freedom Foundation.
The lack of parking in my neighborhood in San Francisco.
I think you said it in your reply. We'll revisit in January.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right.
Let me see just how much work this raising a kid's thing's going
to
be.
All right, man. I'm done if you're done.
I'm done. Yeah.
All right. Thank you very much for your service, Neema. And
thank you too, Mr. D.
I know you're not doing Saturdays, but for some reason you're going to be on this Saturday. I can't
Sundays.
Imagine why.
Not doing Sundays.
Yeah, but you're doing oh, is it?
Yeah, I would have done this Saturday anyway.
Oh, okay. I forget cuz I'm
you
here.
Do.
I'm here all the
yeah.
time.
Yeah.
Yep.
Oh! One last kicker.
Yeah, unless, go ahead.
Do you want to go first?
Well, I was going to say this Sunday and next Sunday it's going to be Bill Buport from No Gov. What is it? Anti Gov. Zero Gov. Dot
zero
something.
Gov.
What is it? I'll look it up.
Yes.
Zero Gov.
I think it's just Zero Gov. Maybe it's zero.gov. Wouldn't that be funny?
Zerogov.com is his website.
Fair enough. When you did that that joke interview with Ben Stone where you used the old man's voice.
Yes.
Yeah. Who are those characters called from the Muppets, the old men?
I don't know that we were necessarily doing them. I just found
that
picture.
But who are those characters in that picture?
I think they're just called the guys in the balcony.
The old guys in the balcony.
Yeah.
Okay, when Lily starts to cry, she looks just like one of them. She's got this old man face when she starts to cry.
Their names are Slater and Waldorf.
Oh, okay. Yeah, she's got a Waldorf face when she starts to cry.
Yeah, Slater.
And that's your kicker.
Slater, I think, has the mustache, and I think Waldorf doesn't.
Okay.
Slater's short and has gray hair and a mustache. Waldorf is taller and has gray hair and balding on the top and no mustache.
No mustache. That's the important part. Yeah. Lily got my full head of hair when she came out, but luckily she doesn't have my facial hair.
So you can call her Reuben Waldorf.
I will. That'll be her other nickname. My little man. Waldorf. All right. Peace.
Peace.
Squirms.
Want to contribute to Liberty but short on cash? You can help the Freedom Fiends without even spending a post-1964 dime. Download uTorrent and start seeding Fiends episodes and DVDs to help keep us drone-proof. There's a Torrent Club link at the top of freedomfiends.com. There you'll find our Torrent RSS feed and instructions to grab past episodes and automatically download new ones, even while you're away from the computer. You'll also get special episodes of The Fiends days or even weeks before regular podcast subscribers who aren't torrenting. Leave your computer on, seeding the torrents while you're at work or asleep. The more people seeding The Fiends, the more drone-proof we'll be when the boot comes down.
Hello, Freedom Fiends. It's your boy, Dean. From the U.S., get the U.S. out my bloodstream. I own me and that include endorphins. No one won't ask permission and I won't say please. Freedom fans, one fact that I gotta make clear.
The Freedom Fiends podcast is covered by a Creative Commons Attribution ShareAlike 3.0 license. Do what you want with it and spread it around. Tell two friends. Make copies. Email it to everyone you know. Go on the site and comment. This is a conversation. Three times a week, Michael W. Dean and Neema Vedadi share their own unique take on the way the world works and how to find your place in it. Available from freedomfiends.com. That's freedomfiends.com. Subscribe and tell two friends.
And remember, the only power they have is the power you allow them. We're not saying the Freedom Fiends are the one true path to anarchist liberation, but it's a good one. If you want to put your voluntarious money where your mouth is, consider making a donation to the Freedom Fiends. Go to freedomfiends.com and click on the spinning coin on any post. Then make a one-time gift via PayPal or set up a monthly contribution of as little as $3. Giving to the Freedom Fiends helps advance education of horizontal liberation throughout the world. The Freedom Fiends. We work hard, so send us some money.
If you like tranny hookers and shooting crocodile, tune in to freedomfiends.com.